folks, and welcome back to my top 100 board games of all time. Starting at number 80 is the best Batman board game that they ever made. And I think you'll all agree with me, Batman Gotham City Mystery. Not even joking. What I love about Batman Gotham City Mystery is you get to play as Nightwing, Robin, Batman, and of course Batgirl, and another player plays as the villain. So you can have up to 2 to 5 players for this game. And what you're trying to do as the villain, you're trying to get all of the items around Gotham that is on your list to complete whatever your evil scheme is. If you can do that before the good guys can guess who you are, you will win the game. Of course, good guys, whenever they capture one of the thugs that are sent out into the city, you get whatever in their backpack. And this is one of the coolest things about this game is it's these little strips, little cardboard strips that you get to put into a bat computer. And the bat computer, all it does is separate the color. There's yellow and black on the each strip. And when you slip it into the bat computer, it will kind of point to who your probable suspects are. All of the blips pertaining to that character must be yellow. If one of them is black, then that eliminates them from the subject list. And so the more thugs you're capturing, the better you are to determine who your villain is. And just because you captured someone who had the cat sculpture made out of pure emerald does not mean you are a fighting Catwoman. No, there's like 3 or 4 other villains who also want that emerald cat sculpture as well. So you can't just go off what you see on the item. You have to go off what you see from the bat computer. I have so much fun playing this game for so many reasons. First off, I love that you can play as Nightwing and Batgirl and Robin. That's really cool. I love the pre-painted minis. They look awesome. I love the artwork in this game. The artwork looks incredible. And this is back in the 90s, back when I was reading a bunch of comic books too, or early 2000s. And the comic book character, this is exactly what they look like when I was reading the comic book at the time. It is such a fun game, a whodunit. Everyone has also some special cards that they can play to help capture the thugs, or the villain can play to help them get away. And it is just so much fun. Now, this is a game for kids. Don't get me wrong. It's a game for kids. But yet, my adult gaming group loves this game. They even request this game to be played sometimes. And I gotta admit, it is the best Batman game out there until Monolith comes out with their Batman game, because that is going to be friggin' sweet. And you better believe I'm going to help with that Kickstarter. Oh, I cannot wait. But for right now, Batman Gotham City Mystery is number 80 on this list. At number 79 is a game I hear virtually nothing about. In fact, I didn't even know it existed until I binge-watched the movies and thought, hey, did they ever make a game about 300? Yeah, 300 is my number 79. Now, 300 is not just a rip-off, you know, of the IP address to make a game real quick to make a bunch of money, which is what I thought it was. Looking at it, I thought, ooh, is this game any good? And when I bought it for $10 online, I thought, oh, maybe it's not good. And I looked at it as like, well, we'll see what we got here. Incredibly fun. You're either playing as the Spartans or the Persians. And of course, as the Spartans, you're just trying to get 100 glory points by the end of 6 rounds. As the Persians, you're just trying to stop the Spartans from getting that much glory. Such a smart game. And by the way, may I suggest you go to BGG and look up the additional rules set forth by the designer of the game. He kind of changed some of the rules, and the game flows a lot better because of his rule changes, and that's how I play the game. But it is really fun. As Spartans, you're guarding the hot gates, and you have the upper hand while you're in the hot gates. But the thing about that is, you're probably not going to get that much glory, because the Persian gets to decide what point values his army will bring to you. And a lot of times, he doesn't have to keep his expensive forces up there. He can just keep them back, way back in the back of the army, and force the Spartans to come out and be on the offensive. In fact, if they can kill Xerxes, he's worth like 20 glory. Now, there's no way. I don't think you could ever kill Xerxes, because that's a hard row to hoe when you were trying to pull and to the Persian camp and kill their captain. I don't see how that can happen. But Persians are super duper strong, and it's awesome to be slaughtering Persians by the dozens out there. But it's also fun to play as the Persians, which I didn't think it would be at first. And I said, let me try as the Persians. As a Persian, it's so satisfying to kill that Spartan, because Spartans, when they get injured, they get even more powerful and start killing people. So when you fail a Spartan on the battlefield, you feel good. As a Persian guy, I actually got into the hot gates a couple of times and came close to getting to the Spartan camp. Of course, Spartans whooped me back out of the hot gates, but it is a really fun game to play. Round marker is actually the little hunchback who is betraying the Spartans. So that's why you have 6 rounds before he makes it to the Persian camp through the secret pass, and he's going to show that to the Persians to win the game. So it's a time game. As Spartans, you don't have time to dilly-dally and let the Persians come to you. Eventually, you're going to have to leave the hot gates and charge on in there and die a glorious death. I'll be honest, this game was actually a really big surprise for me. So if you've looked at it just like I did in the past and said, I don't think that's really good, give it a second shot. It's a fantastic game, and of course my number 79 on the list. At number 78 is the game Temple Run. Temple Run, the board game. This is an app game that they decided to make a board game into, and it's really fun. You're basically running from the demon monkey by rolling this dice, and it's a time game. You hit the idol, it makes the noise from the app, and you have as much time as that idol allows you. You can put the settings on it to have give you more time or less time if you think you're really good at it. And you're rolling the dice over and over again, seeing how many movement rolls you will get on there. Now, any monkey lizards that you roll, they have to stay there, because that's how many times the monkey lizard is going to move up the path. And so what you're doing is, it's a really hurried game, and because of that, you are prone to make mistakes. When I first saw this board, and by the way, these tiles can just switch out. You put one in front of the other, in front of the other, so it's a never-ending, and they're both double-sided, so you can have different, you know, areas to run through and walk through, just like in Temple Run. And I thought, who would ever be dumb enough to end their turn on one of the and fall in one of the holes or hit one of the walls or whatever? I said, that would be stupid. I die like that every single time. Every time I play the game, that's exactly how I die. And of course, it's the last one, you know, left running is the winner. But some people get caught by the monkey lizard, because eventually you will get caught by him. If you do not finish your rolls before time rolls out, you don't get to move at all. In fact, you go to the bottom of the list, bottom of the trail. So whoever's last place, you go right behind them. And that is not fun. I've seen people lose that way. But I just want to get as fast as I can. But you're looking at, you don't even count out your spaces after you've rolled your die, is the thing. And so you count your spaces and go, okay, that's it, I'm going to move 7. Oh no, that puts me right into the hole there. Oh, I died anyway. That's a smart game. I really do enjoy this game. It's short, simple, fun. I had it at number 27 last year. So it kind of fell 51 spots. But that's because I was playing the app a lot at the time. So I loved the app, which I don't play anymore. But when I saw there's a board game version, I said, I got to get this. And we played the board game over and over and over again. I think we've only played it like just a couple of times this year. But that's probably why it's fallen, is because I'm not as into the app game as I used to be. But still, great game. My number 78, Temple Run. Number 77 is one of the few vintage games I left on my list, and that's because it's been reprinted a lot. I have one of the later reprints of this game, and it's a fantastic game. It's called Survive. What you're doing is you're meeples on an island. You're trying to get off the island and onto dry land. But to do that, you have to avoid a ton of hazards. There's sea dragons, there's sharks, there's whales, and if you have the expansion, there's squids as well, which I play with the squids. It's so much fun. And it is nothing but chaos. And I love this game. It's been around for several years. I never played it as a kid. I actually found it a few years ago and just was like, wow, this game is so much fun. Now, on my old list, I had this at number 48. So it has dropped about 29 spots on the list, and that's only because I don't get it to the table as much as I would like. For some reason, I'm a big fan of it, but everyone else is like, they'd rather play something else. Not that they don't like Survive, they'd just rather play something else, because there's a lot of other games I have that they love. I can totally understand that. But for me, oh man, a game of Survive. And by the way, forget the rules on how many meeples you get on the land. Put them all on there, regardless of how many players you have. The more players, the more meeples, the more death and destruction. It is such a fun game. It is such a fun game. It is a take that game where you're basically trying to kill off other people's meeples. And even though you may have more meeples on land than someone else, that still doesn't guarantee you a victory, because underneath each one of the meeples is a number. And so whoever has the highest points of those numbers would be the winner. Great game, Survive, my number 77. My number 76 is from Tasty Minstrel Games. It's called Homesteaders. And this game, you are bidding to build buildings on your land so you can generate resources and money and extra help and everything, because you want to have the biggest and best homestead by the end of the game to win. There is a lot of strategy in this game with such simple mechanisms as that. And I didn't realize that the first time we played. The first time we played, I'm going to give everyone a tip. Win a bid. You've got to win one of the first four bids, or I think you're out of this game. Everyone was trying to go big at the very beginning and bidding exorbitant amounts of money and even taking on debt to win some bids. I was like, nah, forget that. And I lost the first four straight up. And from there on out, I was always behind. I never could catch up. So the game maybe has that going against it, is that, you know, if you don't win some bids at the very beginning, you are going to lose the entire game. But let me tell you this, my board game group absolutely loves this game. In fact, they would be outraged that I ranked it so low. On their list, it would be much, much, much higher. I do love the game. Of course, this is one of the newer games in my collection, so I don't want to, you know, overestimate its value. Now, it could definitely go up, because I admit, even though I sucked the first time playing this, I've kind of gotten the hang of it the next few times. But still, there's a lot of balancing you have to do to make sure you have all the resources to get what you want, to make sure you stay ahead in the game and utilize every little thing you produce. Because that's the key to it. Can you make that homestead work and generate points? Any homestead can do it. You just need to see it before you. And I got some players who really know how that game works, and they'll work with what they got to make the most points out of their homestead. Great game by Taster Minstrel Games. My number 76, Homesteaders. Number 75 is an odd one for me. This one will never appear on anyone else's top 100 but mine. It is one of the few vintage games that I have on my list, and it is Trump the Board Game. Now, hear me out here. Last year at Gen Con, we rented this from the library as a complete joke. We were just going to sit there and laugh about it, and it was probably going to be a terrible game, but we didn't care. We just wanted something to play until another game opened up in the library. Imagine our surprise when, after playing the game, we all loved it. I mean, loved it so much, I went out and bought a copy online through eBay. And Trump, you are basically moving around this board, throwing money into these little hotels that look like, I call them cash coffins. And then, of course, you're bidding on those hotels. Well, all the while, you're going to be playing cards to put more money into those hotels that you bought, so you can have the most money at the end of the game. Now, there, you have to switch up the rules just a little bit. We tweaked one little rule, and the game works perfectly. If you don't tweak a certain rule, one's like you can either choose to grab a card or roll the die. And why wouldn't you grab a card? Cards are very powerful in the game. So there's no reason for anyone to move in the game. So we say you have to move in the game, okay? And then you can get a card. And the game plays a lot better with that. There's trades allowed in this. It's a simple game, but we played it. We played it a lot last year because obviously the elections were going on. And this year it's actually hit the table quite a lot. That's because I guess he's president now. But whenever anyone comes over to my house, they see my collection and they see that Trump game, they go, "No way." And I'm like, "Have you ever played it before? Okay, let's do it." And all of them end up saying, "Wow, this is a great game." Yes. In fact, it's so great, it moved up on the list here. It was number 82 last year. So it moved up 6 spots to the number 75. I guess Trump is just making board games great again. But there it is, Trump, my number 75. Number 74 is the only party game I have on this list. It is Say Anything. And Say Anything, everyone is given a mini dry erase marker and a board, and someone reads off a question, and you're going to write down the answer that you think they'll like best. Once they choose, everyone starts making bets on which one they think the speaker chose. You got two little bet tokens. You can even bet it on your own if you want to. For every token you had on the right answer, you're going to get a point. If you wrote the answer that they picked, you're going to get a point. And then after so many rounds, whoever has the most points wins. Now, I'm not much for party games. In fact, I really don't like party games. But I love Say Anything. Say Anything is so much fun because you can virtually say anything. Now, this is not something you want to play with strangers because it won't be fun. But when you get a good group around you that you know, that you have a lot of jokes in between each other, you can definitely write down anything on this marker board, and everyone is going to have a great time playing this game. Last year, I had it at number 49. It drops 26 spots because I don't really play the party game that much. I still love it. Say Anything is definitely the exception to my rule when it comes to party games, but I just haven't played it this year, and that's why it's dropped a few spots here. Still a great game. My number 74, Say Anything. Number 73 is one of the very few card games I have in my collection. It is called Boss Monster. And Boss Monster, you are a boss of kind of like a Nintendo pixelated boss, and you're trying to build this dungeon to kill off heroes that come into the dungeon. If you kill them off, you get their soul, which is basically just a coin. But if they get through your dungeon, they're going to hurt you and give you a little bloody heart. Now, if you get too many of those, you're going to die and be out of the game. But if you can collect 10 souls, be the first one to do that, you will win the game. There is a huge, rabid fan base for this game, yet I do not see it on anyone's top 100 anywhere. But it was one of the longest lines I had to stay in at Gen Con both years. I mean, those lines went all the way down the hall. So I don't know what the deal is. I guess those people just don't make top 100s. My little brother, this is his favorite game of all time. He loves Boss Monster. In fact, he was the one that told me about it, and then a few friends of mine from when I was visiting Phoenix had me over, and they played the game with me, and I really did enjoy it. And so the guy graciously gave me his copy, and I've been buying the expansions ever since. It is a really fun game. Now, last year I had this game at number 66, so it dropped just a few spaces, like 8 spaces on the rank here, but that's no problem. It's just because I haven't played it as much as my other games. I think this one's only come to the table once this year. I need to play it more. It's still a fantastic game. Love it to death, and I don't really like card playing games. Those games where you're just playing cards and that's it, I don't really like those games. Boss Monster is an exception to that rule. I love Boss Monster. Fantastic game, and my number 73 on this list. Number 72 is a new game to my collection. It's called Dream Home. In Dream Home, you are trying to choose the best rooms and the best combos to create this house to get the most points at the end of the game. Now, there are two rows that you'll be picking from. The top one is the rooms. The second one is like special abilities or add-on bonus points at the end of the game. And it makes for, it's like card drafting here, but you're trying to build this house. I also like the tiebreaker to this game too. If you do have a tie, which has happened a couple of times in our games, you have to look for, it's like a Where's Waldo search after that, because some of the cards have children hidden in them, maybe a little top of a head or an arm or a foot sticking out underneath the bed or something. That is a cool little tiebreaker that you don't really think about when you're playing the game, but when it actually comes down to a tie, you're like, oh man, do I have any kids here? And we actually had a tie on how many kids we had too once. But it doesn't matter. This game is extremely fun to play, very simple, easy to teach. Anyone can play it. For me, it does not get old. I played the game several times. In fact, I'm looking forward to getting the expansion soon and hopefully having even more fun games with this, because Dream Home, Awesome, awesome game. Love playing it. My number 72. And finally, number 71 is Abandoned Ship. This is another new game to my collection here, even though it's been around for a couple of years. And Abandoned Ship, you're a bunch of rats trying to get off the Titanic as it is sinking. So each player is basically going to be drafting these die. They're rolling them and picking one of the die out of there to move one of those rats further up the ship. You see, each player was given a disc that they only know the colors on it. There are three colors on each disc, and they're not all the same. Some players may share the same colors, but they won't be all three exactly the same. So you're trying to get your three rats off the ship to score points, but you don't want them to be the first one off, because the first rat off the ship gets 0 points. So it basically hides the fact of which rat are you actually cheering for, because I see you pushing two or three of them up here, and I know one of them is yours, but one of them you could be just moving up the board just so he'll get first and get 0 points. It's a smart little game there, and I've played this several times with friends. We actually just played it recently again, and everyone that I know just enjoys the game. It takes no amount of previous board game knowledge to play this game. This would probably be a good gateway game for people too. And the little mechanic of the ship sinking and little rats drowning, it may seem kind of morbid, but it's actually a really fun game, which is why it's my 71 on this list. Okay, folks, that's it for now. Hey, come back next time as I talk about my top 70 games of all time. I'll see you then.